My name is Susan Moir, and I am the Director of Research at the University of Massachusetts, Boston. And 2 years ago, I received a Fulbright Nehru scholarship from the government of India and the government of the United States to research conditions of women working in the construction industry, a comparative study of women working in the construction industry in the United States and India. My research area for about 25 years has been women working in the construction industry in the United States. And the story there is that construction is a very good job and women have been kept out of it. So it's a story of occupational segregation, you know.
And how did you get in to this, like why did you start with the construction sector?
Well, I think it's less important why, you know, the story of my life, why I got into construction, than that construction, you know, only 9 to 10% of the economy is in construction. In any country, it's give or take a little, it's about 9-10%. But construction has an incredible multiplier effect in the economy. And that's one of the reasons that the jobs are good working class jobs in the Western economies. So as Mia has said, it's not minimum wage job, it's a living wage job. I think it was you who said it. It's a living wage job. And traditionally in the Western economies, construction is a gateway occupation for migrants, for poor people, for disadvantaged communities. When construction opens up to them, they can make a decent living. And they can get what we call a good job. A good job, you can buy a home, you can send your kids to college, and you can plan for a secure retirement.
It gives also mobility to work in different places?
It does give mobility, although in the United States people don't take advantage of that mobility very much. There is mobility, it is a skill that gives mobility. But mobility is often not a good thing because mobility and migrant can often be the same thing. So when people in the construction industry, when people migrate, some of them may do it by choice, but it's more likely that their regional economy is bad. So they go to someplace where there are the jobs. So an example would be in the 1990s, in many parts of the United States, the construction economy was very depressed. So people went to the Alaska pipeline. They went north to work on, they took their skills and went north to the Alaska pipeline. That wasn't an advancement for them. That was a terrible, terrible job. Very isolated, under very cold conditions, without their families. They did have mobility, but it's more like migrancy than mobility. And in the construction industry, if someone gets, you know, in a good place, more likely they don't want to be mobile. They want to settle down and have a home and not chase work. Work where they are and build a community.
Are you talking more about social mobility though, in terms of like moving up class, like getting a better house?
Okay,
or
then, you can just pass it on.
So I mean, I understand mobility in the sense of like moving location, but are you talking about moving class? Like, are you talking about social mobility when you say mobility?
Actually, in terms of geography, I was saying like, if someone is trained as a mason, now she is a mason and she can go to any city or any place, and she doesn't have to be at one place. Like, she's independent in that way, in terms of geography.
Oh, okay.
In terms of India, I think.
In terms of India, okay. I mean, in terms of the United States, in terms of that type of thing, the other factor are unions as well. So I belong to a union, a local union in Massachusetts. So I work in Massachusetts. Now, if work got slow in Massachusetts and it was booming, say, in California, I might have a chance to migrate to California for work. But if work was slow in Massachusetts and it was slow all over the country, then I probably wouldn't have a chance to go someplace else because unions, they kind of have a pulse. They take a temperature check on what's going on. They know how many workers they can get and how many workers that they can't accept anymore. So I think that's also a factor.
But I think you can keep it because you can respond. Right. I think it is here in India. Yeah, I mean, here in India, I think we could envision that could be the case. In fact, I did hear a story from one woman last year when I was here who was working in on a site in Navi, and she had been in Pune, and she had been trained as a Mason. But then she came to Navi, and nobody would let her work masonry. She was, again, an unskilled laborer. If people in India began to see that women could be masons, then I think, yes, people could move with the work.
And so, and when you started your job, you were, can you introduce yourself?
Sure, my name is Shamia Turner. I'm from Boston, Massachusetts. I'm a sheet metal worker, so I build the large metal containers that move air in big buildings. I work with HVAC systems, heating, ventilation, air, and air conditioning.
It's also very male-dominated.
Yes, so I'm one of very few women in my trade. I think in my trade there might be around 2,000 men, and there might be 7 active women. So it's very, very few of us.
So you are at one of the leadership position among the, like, in the whole job situation. You are at one of the leadership position right now.
Yeah,
you
hold.
Do I have a leadership position? No, I'm at the very beginning of my career. So what happens is you have an apprenticeship, and it could be anywhere from 3 to 5 years. My apprenticeship is 5 years long. So I am a fifth year apprentice, and I'll graduate my program in May. I have leadership positions outside of my job. Like, I'm part of other organizations. Like, I'm on the board of an organization called Women in Leadership Development, and I have other positions like that, but it's not inside of my union.
And do you, like, how media represent these workers? Are there any female role models like they portray?
You're looking at them.
Yeah, are there any female role models media portrays so that women also wants to be a construction worker, or they also want to be a plumber or electrician? How does media does that? Like, do they
Media ignores it. It's invisible. We're about to have a campaign in Boston, where me and I come from, and oh, Kathleen too. We're about to have a campaign in Boston where we're going to have pictures of women construction workers on the buses. And so, and then a place that people can call. So many people think that women don't want to do this work. But I think what's more true is women don't know that they can do this work, and they don't know what to do in order to do this work. So we are going to have a campaign with many women construction workers on the buses with a phone number people can call, and they can get information about how to get into an apprenticeship and become a woman construction worker.
And why is this, like, because
fear controls the mind. That's why people don't know that they can come and do this. But that's why when we're out and about in our daily lives, people see us with our best, or see us, you know, with our boots. And that's where we network and advertise for ourselves that, hey, you can do this too. I get jokes sometimes if I'm on break, how do I get your job? And I stop and talk to them and tell them, how do I get my job? Because the media is not going to do it. But if we just let the media tell us who we can be, then we'll be messed up. So that's where we have to take the initiative by ourselves.
Yeah, the media is very
people aboard. The media didn't tell us about building bridges. Susan came and, hi, I'm trying to do this. That's how you get things changed. You actually have to do it. We can't expect
organized.
The media to do it.
Yeah, organized.
But then institutions like court, judges, lawyers, and media. Do laws are laws like federal laws and state laws? Do they also have this patriarchal mindset, and they also frame law? Just
yes,
very much so. So with the way things are now, we get a very small percentage of the work that's supposed to come to us, but it's minimal. It's nothing near where it needs to be. And it's not enforced fully. So we have to generate our own media, our own vibe around what we're doing to get people interested.
to put that. No, we have a law. We have a law in the United States since 1978 that says that women can be construction workers. Women must be construction workers. Since 1978, that law has not been enforced. It's a small law, but it's a law. And since 1978, that law has not been enforced anywhere. Anywhere.
When you're saying that, that reminds me of the Boston Jobs Residency Policy. Because, so they have, do you call them floors? You would like to refer to them as floors, but they're ceilings. Which are percentages to have, now it's 12% women on the job. And so it's an ordinance throughout the city that you have to make your best faith effort to have that many women on the job. Now, when you say complicated and centered around men, I think of that best faith effort because you have to go through a man to prove that they've made their best faith effort to find the appropriate amount of women to put on that job. And so it's just men talking to each other about, oh, could you find any women? No, I couldn't find any women. Okay, that's good enough. I'll hang up the phone now. So I think that is a good example of what you're talking about. So that ordinance is in place, but the only way for it to have a bunch of women saying, well, we don't have jobs. Where are our jobs? You only have 5% women on this job.
So I can give you an example of one experience I had. I went to a job site. There were no female painters on the job. So I went through the appropriate channels, the compliance officer on the job. I went back to the hall. Look, there's nobody here. You got to do something about it. And we had several meetings set up. They were all blown off by the contractor. He didn't show up at any of them. He's canceled them. I can't make it today. Make it another day. Dragged it out for another couple of weeks. And finally said, give me an apprentice. Because I'm a journey woman, so it means I make the full rate. So he only would break down and hire one woman if he could pay her half the amount of money. He wasn't willing to take me on. So in all my aggravation, I got somebody to work, but they still had a bias against me. They didn't think I was worth my full rate of pay.
Can you explain what is apprenticeship and who makes it, who designs it, and because not many people in India, they know about apprenticeship. What is apprenticeship and how it is done?
Well, let me start with apprenticeship in the West is an ancient institution. It goes back to the early Middle Ages. And it's a male institution. So the artisan would take on apprentice and more apprentice. So the man who made the blacksmith who made the horseshoes or the leather worker who made the saddles, the tailor who made the clothes, they would take on an apprentice. As Kathleen said, the apprentice would be paid very little or nothing, and they would be cheap. And then that apprentice, if the apprentice had a good master, would work up and learn the skills and eventually become a master and take on their own apprentices. It's a very, very long-standing tradition. I'll say that one of the places this tradition still exists is in academia, in higher education, where the professor will take on the young student. And if the student has a good professor, they'll learn a lot and they'll be treated well. And if they have a professor who's just more interested in exploiting their labor, they will not be treated well, not get their education. So you asked me kind of how I got into construction. I feel like I come from higher education. Construction and higher education, it's a very similar system. So the apprenticeship has evolved now in the United States, Canada, most of Western Europe, into a very formal system. And the trades are very well defined. So Mia is a sheet metal worker, Kathleen a painter, and Edwina a laborer. There are 14 different trades. Each of them run their own apprenticeship program. Maybe you guys could say something about what your apprenticeship, what it means to be an apprentice.
Well, my apprenticeship ran for 3 years. So you would go to school for a period of time, and then you would go on the job. So there'd be some on-the-job training. there is some expectation that people on the job are actually going to help you and train you. That sometimes happens, sometimes not. So you could be fending for yourself, and that goes back and forth. And it also goes by the number of hours that you've worked. So as your hours increase, your rate of pay increases. You start at 50% of whatever the rate is. And when you acquire enough hours, you get incremental pay increases along the way until you've reached journey person status.
But the apprenticeship you are talking about is now done by trade unions.
It's done by the trade unions. You pay a fee to get into the union, and you pay a monthly dues. You go to school, and the union helps you to find work. Once you attain journey person status, it's up to you to find your own work, to solicit your own work. So you hope in that apprenticeship period you build up some good relationships with contractors, foremen, that they will continue to hire you back. Because every job is just a series of temporary jobs. The job is finished, you move on. And that contractor may not have another project right in line with when one ends. So it's, you know, it's a revolving situation. Not everybody works all year long. It's very common to have weeks or even months in between jobs off, depending on the trade and the amount of building that's going on in the city. But nobody really wants to, as you talked about traveling, nobody really wants to travel far from home. Everybody wants their work where they live, right, in the city. That's the ideal situation. You don't want to be going crazy looking for work.
In Mumbai, like, everyone is going crazy. Like, one, if someone is living in Mankot, which is away from Kolhapur, then there is Virar. Like, they have to travel 1 hour, 2 hours, 2 hours every day.
Yeah, nobody really wants to do that.
Not, well, every trade is different, because where I live...
Every place is different.
Yeah. Well, in Boston, I should say, yeah. In Boston.
We're living up in the cold north, it's different.
Yeah, I live in Minnesota. Most of the guys in my trade, or in, I do road construction, so we only work half a year. Once the ground freezes, you can't work. But all the guys I work with live 2 hours away. They live on farms, but they want to come to the city because each division pays a different amount of money. And when you're in the metro area, you get paid maybe $5 an hour more than what you would get paid where they live. And then they also get per diem for coming way there, so they're getting so much extra over their pay. And every apprenticeship is different as well, or every trade is different, because as laborers, we can solicit our own work from the beginning. And even after we're journey persons, our union can help us find a job. I take full advantage of being able to find my own work, because sometimes the hall call isn't the best call. It's not for your best interest. So
it depends upon the city also, like where the downtown or the workers are in the center of the city or in the periphery, or most of the time it is outside.
I would say in my trade especially, most of the work is in the city, and then a lot of the guys come from the periphery. They come from the suburbs. They may have started by living in the city, but you can get more bang for your buck if you go out to the suburbs. So a lot of the times the guys will move like an hour or two away. So an hour or two commute a day is not uncommon. What I would say is the difference between the way that we commute in the United States and the way that people migrate in India is you're gonna have a house. You're gonna go back to a nice place to live. Even if you go to another state, you're gonna be put up someplace comfortable. But it seems as if the migrants here, they are put in like very temporary like shanty towns or something while they're working here. That's not the case in America.
And how do you see construction industry, that it is questioning the job which are portrayed for women, like they should be domestic workers, they should be secretary. How is construction work different from all this which are like maybe imposed on woman.
Even in America, it is often told to you that you should be a domestic worker or a secretary or a hairdresser. That's just kind of how you're raised and the direction that you're sent in. To become a construction worker, that's kind of why we all are together here and in the States. We are making it more known, organizing and recruiting women to let them know that they can become construction workers. I've been in for 20 years, and most of the people that I've heard from that got in 20 years ago accidentally fell into it by seeing a sign in somewhere that said, hey, you can earn as much as a man. Or in my case, I thought it looked like I'm a heavy equipment operator, and I just thought it would be fun to learn how to operate a piece of equipment. And I mentioned that to someone, and their mother was actually an instructor at our apprenticeship program. So that's how I applied. I mean, most women accidentally fall into it. So through our group, groups like ours that are coming here to help women in India and across America, we are trying to build a bigger awareness that construction work and earning a better wage and having benefits and a job that you can have pride in is what we're trying to accomplish.
You made a chart of wage comparison between domestic worker and construction worker, and you argued that there is a wage comparison, and the most important point you said was career advancement, that there is a scope that they can keep on moving up.
Yeah, what happened was that one of our days we were out touring, and we were hearing from some people that women, it's very clear that there are, the number of women in construction right now in India is dropping dramatically. And it's hard to tell if that's as a result of the construction industry crash, what's the effect of demonetization, what else is happening, it's hard to tell. But from the time I was here last year to this year, it's dramatically different. I expected to bring the delegation and we would just walk down the street and see women doing construction. Now we're having to look for it. So anyways, what happened was that someone said to me in a conversation I was having, women are going into domestic work, and then in a second conversation someone said to me, oh, it's better for them. It's better for them. They don't have to be outside in the sun and they make more money. So I did a wage comparison. A woman who works for, before even the wages, these are migrant women who have to go out, if they're going to work, do domestic work, they have to somehow or another find someone who will hire them. A lot of them don't have a lot of experience with modern conveniences. Because of caste discrimination, a lot of them can't be in the kitchen. Those who are hiring domestic workers won't let them in the kitchen. So first of all, they have to go out and find those jobs. But let's say they found four people who would let them work rupees a day. It's the same as a construction worker mix. Our other criticism is, at least in construction work, there is the hope of advancement. Women in India can be masons. We know they can. We know from the work that's been done by Sewa and the amazing work that's been done by Achana Women's Center in Kerala. Women can be masons. If they were masons, they would make more money. In domestic work, there's no advancement. Someone actually said to us that there is a new category of work in domestic work where these women are being hired as dusters. They're being hired simply to come in and dust the house. Menial work, meaningless work for the higher caste of India. This does not in any way, the move of women from construction laterally into domestic work does not in any way refute caste discrimination, poverty, advancement of women. All it does is reinforce all those forms of exploitation against the lower caste women of India.
And I know what it's like being a few shades darker in Minnesota, I could tell you. But I can't tell you what it's like being darker in Boston, you know, or Kansas. I can't tell you because I'm not there, and I sure can't tell you about India. Mm-hmm. I didn't know much about India prior to wanting to come here to build.
It was just first impression. Okay, it cannot. We can talk him afterwards.
And you got to wrap it up soon because we have to back. Two more questions.
Willa said the bus is here at 10:30.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it is. Okay. Yeah.
I think everybody else thought 11.
Yeah. Oh, you know, Willa and I backed it up yesterday because we felt like, I mean, we won't leave till 11 because it takes us half an hour to pack the bus.
Yeah.
So if we leave by 11, we're fine.
I think right now there's like a base women's movement, and when you have a special interest in terms of work or in terms of race, you have to advocate for yourself, and that you have to make your voice heard within the larger movement. Unfortunately, some people aren't very focused on intersectionality, but myself, I am. So that's where I would raise my voice and be like, you know, Black Lives Matter, or Women in Construction Matter, or whatever else my special interest is, because unfortunately, not everybody has an eye for what I care about.
So you're talking about the new strategies which you are thinking in the way forward, like or what you want to do next, how you want to build alliances, and how it will go. Like now you have come to India to build bridges. Are you also planning to go to other countries to meet other construction workers in different countries?
I would like to in the future. That probably won't happen this year. This was a lot to take in. This was an enormous adventure for me personally. Really not been out of the country much. And there was so much information here to learn. To take in other countries and the problems of other countries would be a lot at this time. But certainly looking into it, because this is a worldwide problem. This is not just India's problem. It's not just America's. It's a worldwide problem. So it's something I'm committed to in future. I will be making more trips. That's a definite. Just maybe not in 2017. If I take another year, this is also, you know, it's an expensive proposition. It's hard to take away time from work. It's not as simple as just pulling up roots and say, let's go get them. It's not practical, you know. But I am in a position, because I'm older, my children are grown, I have a little bit more flexibility to take off and do things like this. It's just, they have to be well planned.
I want to reinforce, this was an expensive event. The women raised the money themselves to pay for this. But in addition to that, they don't get paid when they don't work. So they're not getting paid at home because they don't have vacation time. If they don't work, they don't get paid. So that's an added expense. So very expensive. I would say something that I've been thinking about. I mean, we have been very focused on construction. Hello, guys? Excuse me. We were doing an interview? Thank you. Something that I've been thinking about is that we've been very focused on construction and women, you know, in India and the U.S. But I think that one thing that our delegation can represent to people and can, you know, talk more about and expand on is just women's inequality in the workplace. You know, that this whole issue of women becoming, in India, becoming domestic workers, I think for me, has really shifted the way I think about this whole thing. Because it's not just what opportunities are there for women in construction, is the key thing. But then, when women don't have those opportunities, what other shifts are happening? And so, you know, the inequality and injustice and exploitation that women face in the workplace all over the world, I think is something that, you know, this delegation represents a challenge to that. And I think that's, you know, something that at least I'll be thinking about more in the future.
And one last question. Your experience in India, whom you have met and what did you see?
Oh, come on.
That's a big question.
I'll take a half an hour.
I'll show
you a list.
No, just about the Nirman Naka workers, and in Kerala you met her.
You know, I was here for 3 months. I met 500 people.
Okay.
And what did I see? I saw 500 things. All right. So, let me see if I can find an answer to this. Very broad. You drive me crazy because your questions are so.
Look, you.
You're driving me crazy.
I'm not a regular interviewer. It's my first time.
All right. I'll take it easy. All right. So, You know, I was here for 3 months last year. I lived here in Bombay. I traveled all around the country. I traveled to Rajasthan, I traveled to Delhi, I traveled to Tamil Nadu, to Kerala, and to Karnataka. And what did I see? I saw a system where I think government is somewhat of a joke. I think your government, I do not see how the government up here cares for the people. I do not see that. I see a people down here who are so incredibly resilient and are making their lives to the very best of their ability without the institution of government that they are elected. Without the supports that government, you know, we saw something that, I've forgotten his name, the original labor organizer in India back in the 19th century, his name starts with an L?
Ambedkar.
No, before Ambedkar. His name starts with an L. He was also Dalit. Anyways, he was inspired by Thomas Paine. And what Thomas Paine said that was so important in the 1700s, which he was the radical founder of our system too, is that government is the manifestation of people's will. Before that, government was such as it was the choice of the monarchy, of the aristocracy. What Thomas Paine said is government is the manifestation of the people's will and their needs. That's why we have a concept called the Commonwealth. My state is called the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Commonwealth. I think something is wrong here. The government is not the manifestation of people's will and their needs. It is something else. I appreciate the democracy, the world's largest democracy. I appreciate that people get to voice and vote so much. But there's something messed up with the government. And people's absolute incredible bravery, resilience, persistence is just completely changed me. I did not imagine that people could just put one foot in front of the other in the face of such adversity and exploitation.